this history.
That's right. How do you hold it together?
Adam Bandt's been a huge inspiration to me as the first Green ever elected in a general election. We've achieved an 11% cut in carbon emissions in this country. We've thrown the brakes on at last to deal with climate change, and that's all thanks to Adam and the work he's been able to do in the lower house. When I was considering whether to run for Batman again in this current election, I did look to Adam's example as a huge inspiration about as what can be achieved by a single representative for a progressive party in the lower house. I'm praying that Adam is elected on the 7th of September and that he can continue the amazing work that he's done for the country and on behalf of the people of his electorate, those lucky people in the federal seat of Melbourne.
To begin with, I would like to introduce Pamela Curr. Pamela works with the refugee advocacy movement to end mandatory detention, as well as assisting men, women and children to adjust to a new life outside detention. She helped in the release of detainee Cornelia Rao by working with a trusted journalist to find Cornelia's family when all other avenues failed. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Pamela.
Hi everybody. I hope you can hear me down the back. Can you?
Yes.
Thank you. I'm really, really honoured to be here to speak for Adam this morning. I first met Adam back in the 90s when I was working with the Outworker campaign, and he was called at short notice to the courts as we were battling to get money for an outworker who hadn't been paid. I know Adam as a man of integrity, and I know him as a man of wisdom. Let's face it, he has spent the last couple of years in the House of Representatives alone. And can't you imagine that the opposition would have loved to have dug the dirt, but they couldn't find it. This man stands up. He has been tested and he has done us proud. He went into the parliament talking about a dental scheme. God knows, those of us who know people too poor to have their teeth fixed know how desperate it is, and he delivered. There's no one in this room who needs convincing that it is absolutely essential that Adam is re-elected to the House of Representatives next weekend. What we have to do is go out and make sure that others, that the electorate of Melbourne, know what is at stake, because we all have fear in our hearts for the election result next week. And we know that the Greens are what stand between utter incivility and our rights, everybody's rights. So I urge you, this is a week that matters. Adam has to be back in that parliament. He has to be that voice, because there is no other to speak for the people of Melbourne and also to contribute to the integrity of our politics in the nation, which is so under threat. So we've got a job on our hands, haven't we? Let's do it. Adam must come back. Thank you.
Thank you all, and thank you, really. I feel like too much of me. Now, look, I'm here because I care. And I have been working on this with Adam every day of the year. We've got so many people among us here in this city needing our support. So why I stand for Adam is not because I just have a political wish. No, I have a humanitarian issue that I stand for. And I have got many people ringing and asking because they don't know where to go. And imagine, and I say this always, if you go to China and you don't speak Chinese, You want to start life somewhere. Where would you start? You need someone to give you a smile, if not even speaking your language, gives you address to walk and to be where. And this is what refugees here in this country are asking. They want just to have a start, to get a hope, to feel as humans. They are wanted, not rejected. They're part of us, not against us. They're not terrorists or bad people or criminals. They're people just running away from being persecuted, being to be killed. And my real dear sister has said she was a refugee, I was a refugee, standing in front of you as proud citizens of this country, and I'm sure many people coming in this country will all make us proud. So let's stand, and especially this government coming now will be hell. As you can see, Middle East is just lighting the fire. As you can see, many other places in the world going the bad side. It worries me another hour to come in power. It worries me another face coming and be border security, be terrorism, be whatever. That is to just oppress and throw people for no reason but to ignore humanity. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is Bob Brown. You all know him.
Thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here with you all today. You know, I was 16 years in the Australian Parliament, and we're in the company of somebody today, also with a name starting with B, but it's Bandt, not Brown, who I predict's going to be there even longer than I was. That's Adam Bandt. One of the reasons for that is in the last election, Adam Bandt stood for empowering Melbourne, giving it a particular voice in the National Parliament to reflect this great city's welcome, its cosmopolitan and extraordinary variety of communities, its place in the world as one of the livable cities that welcomes and celebrates the diversity of humanity and human cultures. And something Adam Bandt has done over these last 3 years is bring that decency and that celebration and that optimism in a fast-moving world into the National Parliament, not just for the people of Melbourne, but for the people of Australia. We have the daunting prospect, but the reality of the unrelenting opinion polls that a fortnight from today there will be an Abbott government. And we have to let people recognise what that will mean for Australia. Adam Bandt and Melbourne have an open door and a welcome to the world. Tony Abbott and that government will slam the door and make this place an unfriendly country that it doesn't in its heart want to be. A selfish country that we Australians don't feel that we want to be. A country of an unfair go, where the richest get richer, the poorer get poorer, and discrimination is rampant, and public services are given across to profiteers. That's the world that's coming down the line, and which makes gold-plated value having a representative in the federal parliament who will be not only hitting the ground running, but who knows how to tackle that sort of philosophy for all of us, whether we are in Melbourne or not. Adam Bandt represents caring, optimism, and defiance against those who don't care about other people, who are discriminatory, and who believe that the great ideal of fundamental rights being met in this country is something that can be put second to self-interest and sectional profiteering. This is a very daunting moment in Australian political history. And in the middle of that is the hope which Christine Milne and her Greens and Janet Rice, who are standing as the lead of the Senate ticket here in Victoria, offer as an option. It may not be getting the coverage it deserves in the media, but electors have this choice. It is a democracy. And if the predictions are right and there is an Abbott government, with that will come a demoralised Labor Party. And that means open door, open card to the rampant Abbott philosophy, which doesn't uphold the ideal of a fair go in Australia. We need, in this next parliament, more than ever, a strong compassion, a humanitarian intellect, a care for both this nation's and the global environment, and a proven voice for the truth. And that's Adam Bandt, the member for Melbourne, who we need in this next parliament. I won't dwell on his role in trying to see that this nation got a fair return from its public-owned mining resources. That this nation extend to everybody the right, not just to a basic education, but a roll gold quality education. That this nation, which was there at the outset with the United Nations, upheld humanitarian laws and the rights of people. That this nation didn't close its door on asylum seekers and shunt them off to our poor neighbours, the richest country on earth, shunting its problems, as it saw asylum seekers, to the poorest countries in our neighbourhood. Adam Bandt has shown in a parliament the voice of fair go, the voice of reason, the voice of a dinkum humanitarian upholding how we see ourselves as a multicultural Australia, and a voice for the rest of this 21st century if we're to live with hope, optimism and a feeling that we're setting an example to the rest of the world. The light on the hill in this next parliament will be kept aflame not by the Labor Party but by Adam Bandt and the Greens. So, ladies and gentlemen, my terrific pleasure to be with you here in this bellwether, green, humanitarian seat of Melbourne, and to introduce to you this afternoon the current member for Melbourne and the member for Melbourne in this next testing parliament, where he'll be needed more than ever, not just for the people of Melbourne, but for the people of Australia. Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Bandt.
Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Tony. I want to acknowledge the traditional owners and pay my respects to their elders past and present, and recognise, especially as we meet here today, that sovereignty was never ceded. And one of the great things that I was pleased that when we signed that agreement with the government to form government, with mine, Bob's and Christine Milne's signatures on it, that we took the first steps in this country to recognise our Indigenous Australians in the Constitution, and something that is long overdue. I want to acknowledge also and point out our next Senator for Victoria, Janet Rice, who's here with us. Our current Senator, Richard Di Natale, and to all the other Members of Parliament, councillors, and all the other guests who are here. I want to start just by telling you a little bit about Penny. Penny is someone that I met when we held a public meeting in Ascot Vale a couple of years ago. And Penny came along to our meeting and said, "This is the first time I've ever been to anything like this by held by a politician." And she said, "Look, I've lived here for a long time, and I'm working in the arts area. I feel like I'm doing all the right things. I've been working hard for a long time, but I'm on repeated contracts. I can't get a mortgage. Rent is getting so high that I'm now potentially going to be moved away from where my friends and family live." And as she started telling the story, tears started forming in her eyes. And she said, "Don't politicians understand that people are doing it extraordinarily tough? People who are trying to do the right thing are now struggling to live a good life. Why isn't that being talked about at the national level?" I can tell you about Neil, who lives over in Parkville, or is soon to live over in Parkville. Neil and his fiancée bought an apartment off the plan that they're intending on moving into at the end of the year, and they bought this apartment not only so that they'd have a place to start their lives, but they bought it because he's the head of the Melbourne Uni Baseball Club, and he wanted to live opposite the only functioning baseball diamond in the area, which sits next to a couple of wetlands that's a few kilometres away from the CBD. And he's now been told that by the time he moves into the apartment at the end of the year, it may in fact be surrounded on three sides by a rat's nest of on and off ramps in leading up to a new leading to and from a tunnel and a freeway that no one wants, and it'll be so close to his balcony that they'll be able to reach out and touch it. And I can tell you the story of someone that Claudia, my fiance, and I met in the Richmond housing estate when we went door knocking there a few weeks ago, and we spoke to someone, a woman who had two kids at school, both playing footy, really vibrant young kids, and she was explaining to us that she now works as a cleaner in one of the hotels here in the city, a 4.5-star hotel, where she's lucky if she gets a few hours work a day, and she waits each morning to get a phone call as to whether she's going to be brought into work or not. And she's doing that after her husband died a few years ago, and she's doing this to make sure her kids lead a good life and are going to be able to go out and find homes of their own, potentially go and follow in the footsteps of others and play football for a team here in Melbourne. And she said as a result of the cuts at the start of this year to her single parent payment, she now finds herself between $100 and $200 worse off, which just makes it absolutely impossible to do things like pay for the footy jumpers. And this is the kind of society that people right around Melbourne, whether it's in the commission flats or in the townhouses, are saying to me that they're worried about. They're worried that this country is becoming less caring, that the gap between rich and poor is growing, that instead of turning Melbourne into a world-class public transport city where you can get around cheaply without having to use a car, that we're potentially being turned into Los Angeles, that we are facing a climate change emergency where we've only got one or two decades to turn this ship around, and instead we're exporting coal at a rate that Australia never has before. These are the issues that should be top of the list in this election campaign. And I presume it's why we have federal members of parliament, to focus on these big picture issues and to think about the long term. But instead, we have got a race to the bottom. We didn't have a debate when it was on television the other day because there were no Greens there. We had drab meanderings around increasingly diminishing points of difference. That's what we had. And it seems that for those of us who thought that maybe a change in leadership in the Labor Party might bring about a change in debate, instead, we're finding ourselves yet again engaged in a competition as to who can be the toughest and who can race most quickly to the bottom. Kevin Rudd doesn't usually take advice from me, but if there's one piece of advice I could give him, it's don't engage in a race to the bottom with Tony Abbott or try and out-tough him, because there's nothing that guy won't do. What we need to do is stand up and offer an alternative. And we've got a choice as politicians. Do we want to play to the worst in people, or do we want to speak to the best in all of us? And that's why we're here today at the Immigration Museum, to remind people that there is another side that beats at the heart of this country. Because unless you're an Indigenous Australian, we're all boat people in some way or another. And when you look around here, as you walk through the museum, and as you look at Carlton and Richmond, and you look in Fitzroy, and you look everywhere around here at Chinatown, you understand that if we had closed our hearts and closed our doors to people coming here from other parts of the world, we would be much poorer for it. And there was a name for it. It was called the White Australia Policy. And we have to make sure that we don't get to a situation where the people who are now living in Richmond who came here after the Vietnam War were, if they were to come here again, are sent off to PNG or sent off to Nauru, because that is exactly what Kevin Rudd and the Labor Party are offering us. And that is why so many people day after day are telling me, look, we're just so disappointed, not only with the state of debate, but with the direction political parties are taking us, and we want a different choice. And one of the other things that this place reminds us, here at the museum and in Melbourne, is that being a refugee isn't something that you are and that you are forever. It's a stage in your life. And it's a stage that people who find themselves in particularly difficult situations are going through, and they are seeking our help, and it's our choice as to whether to help them or not. And what Melbourne reminds us is that when people come seeking help, if you give them a helping hand, they pay you back in spades. And it's that. And it's that that we need to speak to. And to me, it boils down to a pretty simple proposition. You treat boat people like people. And it's not just good for them, and it's not just good for us, but as you would have seen today, it actually saves you money. If we shut down this harsh offshore processing system and these detention centres that wreck kids' lives and that destroy people, and instead we took a leaf out of some of the other countries and said, we will process people here in the community, and we will process more people in the camps in places like Indonesia and Malaysia so that they can come here in a safe way, you'd save $3 billion by doing that. And I tell you what, if you ask most people, would you rather spend $3 billion on an island prison, or would you rather spend $3 billion on universities so that every kid in this country can get a good education no matter what their wealth, I tell you what most people would say. They would say, bring it on. But that's not the choice that we're being offered by the old parties at this election, because they're racing to the bottom when we should be reaching for new heights. That's what an election campaign is meant to be about, focusing on what matters. I left my job in 2007 and started running in elections because of the threat of climate change. We've got a decade or two at most to turn this ship around, or the world that we're going to leave for our kids and our grandkids is going to be one where the bushfires that we saw in Black Saturday are going to start happening every year or two. And the heat waves that killed more people than those bushfires are going to start happening on a regular basis. And that's going to impact on the poor, it's going to impact on the vulnerable, and it's going to impact on the elderly. And so I quit my job and started running in elections. And I am so pleased that because so many people in Melbourne stuck up their hand and said, yes, that's what we think too, we are now world leaders in action on climate change, and we have got $13 billion coming into clean and renewable energy. And that is straight down to the people of Melbourne. And it is a big threat, but it's also an enormous opportunity for this country, because we in this country have to ask ourselves a simple question. What do we want to sell the rest of the world in 15 years' time? What are we going to do to keep this country going when the rest of the world tells us to stop digging? And the answer is Australia could be leading the world with our minds, not our minds. And if we make the right decisions now, people in 10, 20, 30 years' time are going to thank us. Just not far from here, Melbourne University, they have just worked out how to print solar cells onto any surface. And at the moment, they're doing it the same people who do banknotes. But you just think about it for a moment. You could print solar cells. One of the people who's involved in that consortium with them there is BlueScope Steel, because they want to be able to print solar cells straight onto corrugated iron. So you don't need a solar panel on your roof. Your roof is your solar panel. Up at Newcastle University, they're putting microscopic solar cells in paint so that you can just paint the side of your house and all of a sudden your wall is a power source. Just stick a power cord into it and you can run your house off it. Now, if you just think about the applications of this and what it could mean for us here in this country, you can see how Australia can become a world leader in renewable energy in a very short period of time. And I'll tell you what, I would much rather tell my kids that I was involved in making sure that Australia sold solar panels to the rest of the world instead of uranium or coal. And that's the choice that we've got. And the thing is, the money's there for it all. Tony Abbott is one of the most economically irresponsible people in Parliament, which is why he's shying away from approaching the Parliamentary Budget Office to find out actually how much things cost. Because if you go to the Parliamentary Budget Office, as the Greens have done, what you find out is that there's actually a lot of money available to put into education, to put into childcare, to put into renewable energy, if we choose to direct it there. When you go and fill up your car with petrol, you pay 38 cents a litre in tax. When a wealthy miner goes and fills up their truck with diesel, they pay 6 cents because you pay to give them a 32 cent a litre rebate. And that costs us in the order of $8 billion. Well, I think they can pay for their own petrol. That money will more than double pay for Australia to join Obama in spending 3% of our gross domestic product on research and development so that we set ourselves up for the industries of the future. That money, together with a proper mining tax, will mean that we don't have to come and cut university funding to put it into primary schools. We can instead boost university funding by 10% and make sure that everyone in this country is able to go to university no matter how much they earn, and that everyone who works in a university isn't forced to put off starting a family because they don't know whether they're going to have a contract year after next, but they know that they will have a secure job educating everyone in this country. And that's what's at stake this election. And that's why I'm especially pleased that the people of Australia and the organisations that represent them are coming on board for us. We have got, for the first time, the union that represents staff who work in universities, the National Tertiary Education Union, coming on board and saying, make sure you've got Greens in balance of power in the Senate and make sure you have Greens in Melbourne. And I want to thank you so much for coming. And there's many of you here, but we've got Colin Long, who's the head of the Victorian Division and who's the head of the President of the Trades Hall as well. And to have someone like that coming along and saying it's time to put a Greens in Parliament is a seismic shift in Australian politics, and one we welcome and we thank you for it. We've got the Electrical Trades Union, who've got behind us, not only because they know that the Greens will stand up for people's rights at work, and you can trust us on that, but they know that if we follow the German experience, there's 104,000 jobs in renewable energy awaiting us here in Australia. And we've got the Firefighters Union who are here as well, who understand. Yeah. They understand that they don't want their members having to go to more disastrous and more extreme fires that will come if we have climate change, because it will mean destruction for so many of us. We've got the Marine Engineers Union who've got behind us as well. We've got many leading thinkers and respected commentators from the electorate and from across Melbourne who've come out as well. And I especially want to thank, as Burhan said, the various members of the various African communities who have got up and said, we support you as the Greens. You've seen us in action for the first time here as your local member in Melbourne. The fact that you will put on dinners for me and let me come and break bread with you at your iftar dinners and the like at the end of the days of fasting during Ramadan, and then come out and say, we've seen what you do and we like it because you'll stand up for us, humbles me. And I just want to say thank you very much for your support. Now, there's many, many others who have joined us, and I apologise if I've left someone out, but you're generally in good company, but you've got some exceptions, because a couple of other people have come out, and probably unintentionally, but have actually given my campaign quite a boost. First of all, there was Jeff Kennett, who came out and said, I want you to make sure that whatever happens, you don't put Adam Bandt back in Melbourne, because I really want you to elect a Labor Party backbencher for the seat of Melbourne, because I know that they'll side with us on most of the things that matter. And I was worried that he was just going to be a one-off and that was going to be it. But then I got two for the price of one, because Tony Abbott joined him and felt after having seen us in operation in Parliament for the last 3 years, that he better get up there and address the whole country, not about his vision for the future, not about how he was going to make people's lives better, but to tell people who live here that no matter what you do, make sure that you turf Adam out. Because having a Greens in the House of Representatives, just one person there has managed to accomplish far too much, and I want you to turf him out. Well, I think that's a badge of honour, and I thank him for that endorsement. Abbott is launching a campaign today to drive a stake through the egalitarian heart of this country. And he doesn't want Greens in Parliament because he knows that we will stand up to him. And Tony Abbott would much rather that Melbourne elect a Labor backbencher than me, because he knows that I will not vote with him to cut single parent payments, that I will not vote with him to cut university funding, and that unlike Labor, I will not vote with him to excise the whole of Australia from the migration zone. And unlike Labor, I will not vote with Tony Abbott to weaken environmental protections, to continue live exports, or to sign up to a pitiful 5% pollution reduction target that is a death warrant for this planet. And that's why he doesn't want us there. And he also knows that every vote, every time, every Greens will support marriage equality. And he also knows that we will stand firm to say that it is a woman's right to decide what happens with her own body and a woman's right to choose, and we will stand up to you every single time you try and take it. Now, I am thrilled at how much we've achieved. I've mentioned clean energy. It gladdens my heart to know that because the people of Melbourne voted Greens last time, from the start of next year, parents will be able to take their kids to the dentist using their Medicare card to be able to get Medicare-funded dental. That's something that's going to put a smile on a lot of people's faces. And I'm thrilled that because we were there, we were able to get some extra protections for firefighters. If this room catches on fire now, we'll all run one way, they'll come in the other. And when they come in, the chemicals that are in here are going to cause some toxic smoke that leaches through their uniforms, and it's giving them cancer. And up till now, every time they used to go to the lawyers and say, well, we need some compensation, the lawyers would say, well, unless you can tell us particularly at which fire you contracted this disease, you won't get any. And so shift mates were covering each other when someone had to go off and undergo chemotherapy or radiotherapy. We've managed to change the law federally so it's now presumed that any cancers they get will have been caused by the job, and so they and their families will get the compensation that they're entitled to because we were there. And the best bit is, the best is yet to come. And people in Melbourne now can do something that no one else can in this country. They can return a Greens member to the House of Representatives. And they can not only get Tony Abbott out, but you can get someone who will vote for the values that Melbourne shares and will speak up for them and will not be silenced by the factional leaders, because this is something that is far too important. And what they also know is that they'll get what is so dearly lacking in this country, a vision and a plan. And because I'm not an economic fringe dweller like Tony Abbott, we've had ours costed. I had someone rang up our office and said, thank you for sending me something that actually tells me what you're going to do, where the money will come from, and how you will spend it, because it's nice to be treated like an adult by a politician. And that's what the Greens are about. And the vision that we are offering is for a Melbourne where your name or your headscarf or the colour of your skin doesn't determine where you get a job interview. It's a vision of a Melbourne where women are able to return to work after having kids because the childcare places are accessible and affordable. And it's a Melbourne where Neil doesn't have to worry about open space because we're not turning ourselves into Los Angeles, we're turning ourselves into a world-class public transport city where you can get around without a car and where parents are able to stick the kids on the back of their bikes and ride around and know that it's super safe. And we're offering a vision for an Australia where single parents are treated with respect and aren't attacked to help balance the budget while Gina Rinehart gets off scot-free. And it's a plan for an Australia where Penny is able to live in a place near her friends, near where she works and has a secure job. And we want to live in an Australia where a job that's dependent on the health of the Great Barrier Reef or on the survival of our forests is treated as just as important as a job making a car or a job in mining. And we are offering a vision for an Australia where in 15 years' time, we're not just digging it up, cutting it down and shipping it off, but where we are regarded as world leaders in everything that matters. And it's that that means people are coming up to me day after day and saying, yep, I'm going to change my vote this time. And I'm quite excited about the next couple of weeks because I've had people stop me in the street to say, you know, your door knocker just came and grabbed me the other day and I was in bed but I got out and I had a chat with them. And after I worked out what I wanted to ask, it was really good. I've never had anyone from a political party come and talk to me before. And I was standing out the front of Richmond Coles the other day, and a guy ran into the Coles with his name badge on. He was going to work. And then he ducked out a minute afterwards and said, look, one of your phone people rang me last night, and they had a couple of questions. Oh, I had a couple of questions. They couldn't answer them. They said they would get on to you. Can you answer the questions for me? And I said, yes, I'll answer them. He said, good. Oh, look, can you tell them not to call back? They don't need to call back. I've spoken to the boss. It's all right. And that is happening to me everywhere I go. Everywhere I go in Melbourne now, there is someone from this campaign who has gone and knocked on their door or spoken to them or rung them up. And it is making a huge difference. And people are telling us in droves that at this election they are going to change their votes. And it is in large part not just because I get to stand on the shoulders of giants like Bob Brown. Please give him another round. And it's not just because we were able to put forward a vision which is so sorely lacking, but it's because of people like you. And many of you have been the public faces of the campaign, and I want to invite some of them up to join us here on stage. And I think Michelle in particular, I think it's Michelle coming up. Michelle very kindly opened her house to Claudia and I and a dozen other strangers the other week and cooked us all dinner, and it was fantastic. And I was sitting there talking to them all, saying, and I presumed they'd all knew each other, and they said, no, we've never met each other before. Michelle just opened her house to us on Facebook. And that is what's happening week after week, day after day here in this electorate. People are getting to know each other, and we're getting back to what politics is meant to be about. And so I am thrilled not only to be standing up for what matters, but to be standing here with so many other people who are saying it is time to make sure we do here in Melbourne something that no one else can do, and that is keep a Greens voice in the lower house of Parliament. Thank you.
It's been just so critical having Adam Bandt elected to the lower house in Melbourne, just as it's been having the Greens in the balance of power in the Senate. Having balance of power in both houses of Parliament has given us the opportunity to do some incredible things. It's given us the opportunity to introduce some of the world's most ambitious climate change legislation, and that's because we had Adam in the lower house and the Greens in the balance of power in the Senate. We've now got, for the first time, young kids who are going to get Medicare-funded dental care for the very, very first time. So from January 1 and next year, we're going to see young children going to the dentist and having their dental care paid by Medicare. So it becomes just like going to the doctor. And that's because having the opportunity to have Adam in the lower house in a share of balance of power and having the Greens in the balance of power of the Senate has given us those incredible opportunities. And we just hope that come the 2013 election, we've got the opportunity to do more good things.